Order. Members will have been saddened to learn of the passing of the former First Minister, the Right Honourable Lord Bannside. Before I pay my own tribute, I should advise you that the Business Committee has agreed, as a mark of respect, to adjourn today's sitting after members have had the opportunity to speak. This requires a formal item of business, which I will take now. Order, members, the motion to suspend, standing order. Clerk, please read the motion.
That Standing Order 20, brackets 1, be suspended for the 15th of September 2014.
And I call Mr Peter Weir to move the motion.
So moved.
Before we proceed to the question, I would remind members that this motion requires cross-community support. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. As there are ayes from all sides of the House and there are no dissenting voices, I am satisfied that cross-community support has been demonstrated. The motion is agreed. Before we go any further, could I just inform the House that the Speaker has asked me to convey his apologies that he is unable to be here due to ill health. And members will appreciate that given the long personal connection and political connection between the Hay family and the late Lord Bannside, he would have wished to be here. But I'm sure the House will join with me in wishing the Speaker a speedy recovery. One of the saddest duties from this chair is to report to the House the passing of former or current colleagues. However, it always serves to remind us that no matter about the heat of the political disagreements we have in this House or elsewhere, we are ultimately all made of the same flesh and bone. I know that members will have different views on Ian Paisley's politics and his legacy that they will want all at any time to express, but it is not for me to dwell on that from this chair. But there is no doubt that the former First Minister was instrumental and has all been in the chamber today. Indeed, he will have influenced the politics of members on all sides of this House. I think members will agree that politics has lost a giant personality, and the international coverage since his passing acts as proof of that. To opponents or the public, in speeches or in interviews, Ian Paisley may have come across as a strident, foreboding character, but I know that many in this chamber will also hold valued memories of his warm and personal nature. And that came across in his reputation as a champion of all his constituents and, of course, combined with a sense of humour. On the election campaign trail, it made him a force of nature. It is often the case that some of the most significant and memorable political figures are those who provoke a strong emotional reaction, positive and negative. Ian Paisley did that. He was straight-talking, whether you liked what he said or not. However, let us remember today that regardless of his political contribution, he regarded himself first and foremost as a man of faith and family. And we express our heartfelt condolences to Baroness Paisley and the entire Paisley family. It is safe to say that Northern politics would not have been the same without Ian Paisley. May he rest in peace. And as is customary, I will now invite party leaders to speak for about 5 minutes to pay tribute to our late friend and colleague. I will not be imposing strict time constraints, but I would encourage members to be brief, no more than 3 minutes, to give time for as many as possible in the hour and a half that has been allocated for tributes. And when tributes have concluded, members are invited to join me in signing the Book of Condolence in the Great Hall. And the Book of Condolence will be available for members and for staff who work in this building and users of this building to sign until 3 p.m. this afternoon, after which it will be opened to the public. And the House will now pay its own respects, and I call Mr Peter Robinson.
Mr Principal Deputy Speaker, the custom on occasions such as this is to comment and reflect on the life, service and contribution of the person who has passed away. But when the person is someone who, head and shoulders above all others, strode and dominated the public stage for a time beyond the adult life of all of us who sit in this House, it's a daunting task and one that no eloquence or command of detail could in truth and with fairness accomplish. Ian Paisley was a remarkable man whose long career in public life has left an indelible mark upon all of us who knew him. Like so many, I was drawn towards politics by the clarity, the certainty, the strength and the conviction of his message. The big man, as he was known, provided firm and decisive leadership when unionism lacked it most and when it needed it most. The stage for his oratory ranged from the lofty debating chambers of the Mother of Parliaments and the European Parliament to countless halls and meeting rooms across the land. He was as much at home speaking on top of a wooden crate or on a lorry platform in an open field as he was from the green or red benches at Westminster. Yet he had a special place in his heart for this chamber. Whether on the opposition benches or as First Minister on this side, he loved Stormont. He could energise and inspire those around him like no other person I had met before or have met since. He loved Ulster and her people, and they returned that love and trust by repeatedly lifting him to the top of the poll in North Antrim and then giving him poll-topping success in 5 consecutive Northern Ireland-wide European elections. He had a sincere interest in people's problems, no matter who they were or whether their problems were large or small. There are multitudes that have been touched by individual acts of kindness carried away from the gaze of the media or the public. For most of his life, Ian was blessed to have Eileen by his side. Whether he was battling in the valley or marching on the mountaintop, she gave him decades of love and support. At this sad time, our prayers are with Baroness Paisley, her children, grandchildren and great-grandchildren. He was as special to them as they were to him, for his was a close and loving family circle. Those of us who knew him best will remember the fun and joy it was to be in his company. But today we close the page on a long and glorious era, and already politics seems a little less colourful and exciting. Ian has taken his place in the chronicles of Ulster history alongside the greats of unionism, making our heritage even richer. As a leader of men, a friend of the people, a servant of the state, and the undisputed leader of unionism, Ian Paisley outclassed all around him. Ulster will never see the like of him again. He was an exceptional human being. He had a loyal heart, a fidelity to freedom, a passion for democracy, and a love for public service. In the storm, he was oak and granite, and in the sunshine, he radiated passion and commitment. Ian's faith shaped his entire life. We will never know this side of eternity just how many thousands of lives were changed through his preaching and witness. In a sermon he once preached entitled 5 Minutes After Death, he said, "If you read that Ian Paisley is dead, don't believe it, for I'll be more alive than ever and singing like I've never sung before." Those of us who stood beside him when he did sing will know how blessed a hope that is. But I was present when Ian made what was probably his final major speech at an event in Hillsborough Castle, when he, along with the Deputy First Minister and I, were awarded the International Ellis Island Medal of Honour. Though his strength was waning and he moved slowly to the platform, his message displayed the clarity of his mind and the certainty of his convictions. He told of a time when he knelt at the feet of the Saviour of the world and received eternal life. He told us that it was this that had driven him all his years and would drive him through the gates of eternity to the land that is fairer than day, where wars will be no more, where darkness shall surrender to eternal light, and where we will sit in the majesty of God himself. He pronounced that in Northern Ireland we were moving in the right direction. And though we were facing significant problems, he encouraged us all to complete the journey. He expressed the hope that future generations would be able to live in peace and urged us to do our bit to reach that goal. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, he no longer sits among us, but we are entrusted with his legacy, and we are stirred by his injunction to finish the course and do our bit in securing lasting peace and stability for the land he loves so much.
Thank you, and I call Martin McGuinness.
I too want to thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker, for the opportunity to say a few words about Ian Paisley today. First of all, I want to wish our Speaker, William Hay, well. Presently in hospital, I hope he recovers very quickly indeed. This is a very sad occasion for all of us. And I have very fond memories of that weekend in the spring of 2007 when the First Minister and I, as Peter Robinson and Martin McGuinness with no titles, sat down with other members of our party to work out and craft a statement that would be issued by Ian Paisley and Gerry Adams the following Monday. A statement which confounded the international community who had arrived en masse to proclaim yet another glorious failure in the peace process. That was a very remarkable experience, and all the more remarkable because I remember as an 18, 19-year-old on the streets of Derry, being like most of the other population in Derry, in fear of Ian Paisley whenever he came to the city. His huge stature, his booming voice, his politics that we didn't share or like. And there's been a lot of talk about that over the course of the last couple of days. A lot of criticism of the actions that he was involved in the past. And I say that also conscious that from a unionist perspective, that there are also a lot of perceptions and criticisms of people on this side of this assembly. So I will leave it to history to decide on Ian Paisley's legacy. I can really only talk about my experiences with him. Those negotiations that the First Minister and I were involved in brought Ian Paisley and myself into the office of First and Deputy First Minister on the basis of equality. And I have to say, it was one of the most memorable experiences of my life to be in that office with him for that year. From the word go, for some reason, we hit it off. Not alone did we develop a positive and constructive working relationship, but we actually became friends. We grew to like each other. And that, incredible for people who undoubtedly for many decades intensely disliked each other. But we genuinely grew to like each other, and in doing so, we confounded the world. And I think that was a good thing. He certainly made a huge effort. One of the first conversations that he and I had together, he said to me, "Martin, you know, we can rule ourselves. We don't need these people coming over from England telling us what to do." On another occasion when we met with representatives of the factions in conflict in Afghanistan here in Parliament Buildings, he went out of his way to describe himself, as I know he has done on previous occasions, as an Ulster man and an Irish man. Stressing, of course, the Ulster man came first. But those two statements were common ground that we could stand on. And as I said, it was an incredible experience. In December 2007, we went off to the United States of America to begin the work of trying to attract foreign direct investment so we could give our people jobs and show the world that we were open for business and that a transformation had taken place. And I'll never forget the meeting that he and I were involved in with President George Bush in the Oval Office, which was supposedly to last 20 minutes and lasted well over an hour. It was an incredible experience. We were accompanied on that visit by the late John Harrison, well known to everybody in this assembly, someone also that we had a great friendship with and a great love for. And Ian Paisley loved John Harrison. We had a memorable experience in the Oval Office when one of our press officers, Paddy Cullen, was told by John, he thrust a camera into his hand, he said, snap everything in sight, when a flotilla of press people came in. And the sight of Paddy Cullen jumping up on President Bush's sofa to take the photographs always got a great laugh between Ian and myself. It's not so long ago I went to see Ian and Eileen at their home for coffee. I spent almost 2 hours with them. And I was really glad that we had that opportunity to talk. It was obvious to me that he was visibly weakening. But he had a project in mind, and it was a project that he wanted me to attend. Sadly, that will not now be the case. But we had a great conversation for 2 hours. And I do regard Ian Paisley and Eileen Paisley as two of the strongest supporters of the peace process that anybody can imagine. And I think I can say that without fear of contradiction. So I too, along with everybody else, want to extend my deepest sympathy and condolences to Eileen Paisley, to her children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren. I think she is a remarkable woman. I think she played a very powerful role in a lot of the political changes that brought many of us together in this House. Sometimes I think that's not recognised enough. When Ian left office, I asked the late, great Seamus Heaney to write out the Hope and History poem. And Seamus wrote it out in his own hand in the most beautiful parchment paper you could imagine. And we got it framed, and I was to make a presentation to him. And when I did that in the executive room, I also presented him with one of my own poems about disappearing sea trout on the west coast of Ireland and Native American Indians. About a month later, Ian asked to see me. He was in his own new room after he had left office here in Parliament Buildings. I went up to the room, brought into a side room, and there on the wall was Seamus Heaney's poem alongside mine. And I said to him, I appreciate very much you raising me to the elite of the poets. And we had a great laugh about that. I was part of the delegation that went to Liverpool to argue for city of culture status for my own city. We made the case. When the announcement was to be made, it was to be made on the One Show. And we were all there for the announcement. The announcement was made. We won against all odds. First phone call I received after I stepped down off the podium was from Ian Paisley. He said, Martin, I've just been watching you on TV. It's a fantastic result for the city and a great result for our young people. And that had a tremendous effect on me. Now, I know at the same time that when Ian left office, a number of reasons have been cited by journalists and so forth. And the reasons were some people said that the DUP thought that he was elderly. And he was. But Oller said it was also because he was too friendly with myself. And there's food for thought There's food for thought and all of that for every single member of this House in terms of his ability coming from where he came from to bridge the differences with me. And as I said when I wrote in the book of condolence in my own city at the weekend, that in rising above old enmities, we pointed the way to a better and peaceful future. I do believe that the peace process has lost a great friend, and I have lost a friend. I know some people in the Republican community have taken exception over the weekend to me saying that. I've heard that. It's been on the social networks. But I would say to them, if F.W. de Klerk had a day before Nelson Mandela, what would Nelson Mandela have said about F.W. de Klerk? So we all have to rise to the occasion, folks. This is about peacemaking. It's about building a better future for our young people. And I want to end on that note. I think Ian Paisley, whatever about his past, done a magnificent service for our young people and for the future. And for that, I am proud to be associated with him.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Alistair MacDonald.
Well, thank you very much, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And like others who have already spoken, I want to wish our Speaker, Willie Hay, a speedy recovery to good health, because we miss him, and I'm just saddened that he's not able to be with us here this morning. But my main purpose in rising is that I rise to express my sincerest sympathy, the sympathy of my colleagues and the sympathy of the SDLP, to Baroness Paisley and the family, the children, the grandchildren. And I also extend a heartfelt sympathy to colleagues opposite, and indeed DUP colleagues of Lord Bannside across Northern Ireland. I could never and would never agree with much of Ian Paisley's politics, but that was understood and that was fairly clear. But I have to pay tribute to him as a committed constituency representative and a dedicated public servant. I'm not going to delve into the whys or the wherefores or the why nots, and I will leave it to others and to history to judge the contribution Ian Paisley made to this place, particularly in the latter days, helping to bring about peace and devolution. He made in 2007 his efforts ensured that power sharing was put back into place, devolution was put back into place. But today our thoughts are with the family and friends. I have known Ian Paisley for over 40 years. I don't want to admit how many years over 40, but it's a while. And despite fundamental political differences, at a personal level, we had many conversations and an enduring personal friendship that defied political differences. So, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, our thoughts and our sympathy today must be with Eileen Baroness Paisley and the extended family and the grandchildren who are grieving and trying to come to terms with this sad loss. We can move on in this chamber at various speeds. Some of us will maybe be able to move on quicker than others. But the point is, the family are left there with a big gap in their lives. There's a husband, a father, a grandfather missing. And my sympathy and the sympathy of the SDLP goes out to all of them on this sad and difficult day. Thank you.
And I call Mr. Mike Nesbitt.
As I begin, Principal Deputy Speaker, may I, on behalf of this party, send our best wishes to the Speaker. You have acknowledged that Willie Hay has been taken all well. The Ulster Unionist Party wishes him a full and speedy recovery, and we look forward to seeing him back in this chamber as soon as possible. I stand representing the Ulster Unionist Party to acknowledge the loss of Ian Paisley, a loss which will be felt most keenly by his family and by the members of this chamber to my left. I was in my constituency office on Friday when the news came through, helping a family in need, and I believe it is to the Paisley family that our thoughts should turn today. It's a powerful consideration that his widow, Baroness Paisley, was married to Lord Bannside for longer than many members in this chamber have been alive. This week, Eileen Paisley finds herself in a position she has not been in since 1956, not having a husband to turn to for comfort and for companionship. I have no doubt her faith and her family will be comforts of immeasurable strength at this time. I don't know what value she'll place in the thoughts and prayers of the Ulster Unionist Party, but let me assure the House she and her family are very much in our thoughts at this time. Ian Paisley was a huge figure, physically and metaphorically. He also made huge decisions that affected all of us in the most profound way. But I do not believe that this is the day for me to analyse his leadership or its legacy. This is the day of his funeral, and I wish to be respectful of that occasion. There'll be plenty of time to reflect on political relationships, on rationales, and on that legacy. My personal relationship with Dr. Paisley was more centred on my days as a broadcast journalist than as a politician, and I have to say, interviewing Ian Paisley was always something of an event. If you had not been admonished by Ian Paisley, you could not consider yourself a proper journalist. But now he's gone, as has Albert Reynolds, John Major, John Hume, David Trimble, Bill Clinton, Tony Blair, Bertie Ahern, and many, many others have all left the mainstream political stage, and yet we are still a long way from where they and we would like to be. So on this day that a family mourns, let us keep the Paisley household foremost in our thoughts, but let us also commit to finish our political journey, a journey that took Ian Paisley on a remarkable voyage for better and worse. Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, I understand there are many, many members wishing to speak today, so I'll finish here to allow as many as possible to record their memories of the Lord Bannside.
Thank you. And I call Mr. David Ford.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And on behalf of my colleagues, both in this chamber and in the Alliance Party generally, I would also wish to express our sympathy to Eileen Baroness Paisley, to her children, grandchildren, the family circle, and those who loved and respected Ian Paisley most. And also, as you have done, we would wish to record our best wishes to the Speaker for speedy recovery to see him back in his place in this Assembly. Ian Paisley was certainly a man of many parts. He was a preacher, he was a politician, he was also, of course, a partner and a parent. Many of us in this chamber disagreed with many of the things that Ian Paisley did and many of the things that Ian Paisley said over a period of many years. And we should not seek to brush that aside as we look at his legacy. The journalists are already asking the what if and the what if not questions. But the reason why we are here paying tribute today is because he became First Minister of Northern Ireland, and he played his part in that. The day he stepped down from office, I remember saying historians would have to judge whether he was remembered for 40 years of saying no or 2 years of saying yes. But what we can commemorate today is the fact that we have here a working assembly, and he played a significant part in ensuring that that happened. I can certainly remember as far back as the 1970s, when as well as the preacher and the politician with the fiery rhetoric, there was also an assiduous constituency worker. I know that my colleagues in the Northern Health and Social Services Board saw many typewritten ribbons, that's how long ago it was, worn out in the letters of reply that went back as he followed up the case of any constituent who went to him, and I've no doubt that Health and Social Services was not the only public agency that bore the brunt of his representations on behalf of the people of North Antrim, and of course subsequently as an MEP of any part of Northern Ireland he cared to follow up. I personally got to know him particularly well when, following the Good Friday Agreement, and the full restoration of powers to this place. I was a member of the Agriculture Committee, which he chaired. And there's no doubt that that was a time when some of us will remember all was not particularly easy in this chamber, sometimes sitting in the alliance wedge immediately between the DUP and Sinn Féin. It was not always the easiest place to be within this chamber. And yet within the committee, even though Ian Paisley was reluctant sometimes to use people's names, at the point when he got to looking down the table, pointing and saying, this gentleman will now ask a question, and the gentleman in question was our former colleague Francis Molloy, he did prove that the political did not have to become the personal as well, and he could take that forward. It's clear that in those years following the Good Friday Agreement, those years when the balance of power within unionism changed, he could see a different role. And I remember a conversation in what was clearly the period that led up to the St Andrews Agreement, although it was some time before it. It was a private conversation. It was not one that I reported. It was clear from that conversation, however, that he could see that there was a need for change, that he wanted to see change happen, and he wanted to be part of something positive. And he sought to bring his party around to that view, and he sought to bring his party along with others to that position. And eventually, of course, at St Andrews, and then in talks in and around this building in the spring of 2007, he saw that happen. Many journalists over the last few days have said that only he could have brought the DUP into that form of power sharing. I tend to agree, because the reputation he'd established, the certainty with which he led his party, gave him the authority and the courage to make that change, to bring us to where we are in these institutions today with credibility and around change. I suspect historians will record little of his actions as First Minister. The crucial issue was that he brought about change in which he became First Minister in a partnership, power-sharing executive in this building. And the fact that he did so presented us, as others have said, with the opportunities and the challenges that we face in the difficult circumstances we're in today. And if we're going to pay any respect to the legacy of Ian Paisley, it will not just be in the words which we utter in this chamber today, but it will be in a firm commitment to build on the agreements of 1998 and 2007 and embed power-sharing, devolved government in a way which ensures that we collectively meet the needs of the people of Northern Ireland. But that is a point for the future. Today, let us remember the family bearing their loved one and the loss that they in particular suffer.
And I call Mr. Jim Allister.
It is natural that in this political place there should be a particular focus on the highly significant and highly successful politician that Ian Paisley was. But to those who will miss him most, above all that, he was a devoted husband, a loving father, and a caring grandfather and great-grandfather. Anyone who knew Ian Paisley knew that next to his faith, his family was all important to him. The way in which he loved, cared for, protected, and promoted them was central for him. And he did it as he did most things, single-mindedly and unabashed. The mutual devotion between him and his wife, Eileen, was legendary. And thus today, we should think most of those who will miss him most. And both personally and on behalf of my party, I wish to pass on to the Paisley family our sympathies at this time of great loss for them. I have many good memories of earlier years. This House and the wider public know that in more recent times I had significant differences with Ian Paisley. I do not intend to dwell on them today, But I would not be true to myself if I did not record that it is, of course, an abiding regret for me that after his decades of principled stand, his legacy in this House is terrorists in government and a system not fit for purpose. None of that would have been possible without Ian Paisley. The arrangements that needed to be sold to those they needed to be sold to could only be sold by Ian Paisley. And by any standard, his was a remarkable political journey. Whether one approves or disapproves of it, one can but marvel at the journey from being the scourge of republicanism to the proclaimed friend of an unrepentant IRA commander. But whatever one's disagreements with Ian Paisley, you couldn't help but like him. A big man in every sense. He had many charming characteristics. He was great company. He was compassionate to those in need. And in public life, he was a colossus. His personal charisma was key to his success. His easy ability to relate to all in all walks of life. That ability, which he had in abundance, was remarkable to observe. And of course, it induced in many an unshakable loyalty towards him. I would venture to say that Ian Paisley was the most charismatic politician that these islands produced in the 20th century. Yes, he could have a sharp tongue, felt sometimes by friends as well as foes. Yes, it wasn't always deployed judiciously. But in his day, he was an orator in this land without equal. It made him into a renowned parliamentarian who used those oratorical skills to great effect. In his prime, both in this place and in the House of Commons, he was in a league of his own. In the pulpit too, he was a prince of preachers. And many have reason to be eternally grateful for his ministry there. It has been said, but it bears repetition, we will not see the like of him again. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Stephen Agnew.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Ian Paisley had many titles over the years. The most recent is the Lord Bannside. He, of course, has been a councillor, an MLA, an MP, a member of the European Parliament, and as well as that, he's had the titles Reverend and Doctor in front of his name. But ultimately, when we get to sickness and ultimately death, all these titles strip away the status that they proclaim upon us can mean very little, and what we're left with is a man, a human being, who is vulnerable to life's final conclusion. And I think that's important to remember when the death of a public figure comes, and remember the vulnerability of the family at this time and the difficulties they face. It was with much regret that I witnessed some of the comment and reaction to the death of Margaret Thatcher and how people responded to that. I think the time when a public figure, a politician, retires is the time to reflect on their political career and to pass comment and pass judgment on that. I think today we mourn the death of a human being, much more so than the various roles they played in their life. And I make the comparison, and I think it's an apt one, because both figures were people who had a huge impact on our politics, Ian Paisley, particularly in Northern Ireland, but there's no doubt his importance went well beyond this province. But both equally divided opinion, and would emote a strong reaction in people. But as I say, I think it's on the time of someone's death, it's a time to moderate our reactions and be respectful to the memory of the person and to the grieving family and indeed friends and wider circle. I've heard it asked many times over the last few days, you know, what will history conclude? What will the final analysis be on Ian Paisley? What will be his legacy? And I think, come back to what Mr. Robinson said, it you certainly couldn't, in a short space, sum up Ian Paisley, and I don't think history will ever become able to reconcile with a standard narrative of what his impact was on the politics of Northern Ireland and beyond. He was too significant a man, too complex a man, to ever distill him down to such an easy conclusion. But as many have suggested, if his legacy is to be that we have these assembly institutions, that he perhaps was a significant, if not the final piece in getting stable politics in Northern Ireland, then I think it is incumbent to all those who rise to pay tribute to him today that we do everything in our efforts, and it is noticeable that both the First and Deputy First Minister spoke with such fondness towards the man, that all of us, but particularly those in positions of the highest responsibility, do everything in their power to ensure that legacy, if that indeed is to be how we finally assess the contribution of Ian Paisley, that we do everything we can to make these institutions work for peace in Northern Ireland and for the betterment of our citizens. On behalf of myself and the Green Party in Northern Ireland, I'd like to extend our deepest condolences to the Paisley family, to his friends, and to all his many, many well-wishers. Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker.
And I call Mr. David McNary.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. On behalf of Nigel Farage and myself, I extend our condolence and sympathy to Baron Ms. Paisley and the family circle. Our thoughts and our prayers are, of course, with them. We are gathered to pay tribute to Ian Paisley as our former First Minister. And this is a time for respect. So let's face it and be honest. Without Ian Paisley saying yes and embracing power sharing, this Assembly would not be here today, nor would we be in a position to be making this tribute. I suspect, listening to us right now, some sworn enemies, some hypocrites, some in genuine grief and despair, I figure that the doc would be having a good chuckle. His sense of humour, certainly for me, took us through many traumas. He shocked outsiders and insiders when he led the DUP into power sharing with Republicans. It was an amazing time, an amazing day when he made that decision. Some concluded then disappointment in him. Well, I didn't. How could you be disappointed when he took on and took over? The groundwork cleared out painfully and to the cost of others before him, which culminated in him walking into office as First Minister. I'd like to think, Principal Deputy Speaker, that whilst the issue was the same for any unionist, and therefore fraught with complexities, the solution in the end proved to be relatively simple. Ultimately, he chose what he thought was good for the people and best for the country. And it is in that context that I pay tribute to him. So I say respectfully, thanks, Doc. The never moved toward a maybe, which turned into a yes. A yes for work in progress, a yes to move forward, and a yes to ensuring Northern Ireland's continued Britishness. Our job, I think, from here on is to hold that line and to do what we think is best for our country. I say rest in peace, Dr. Paisley, and thank you for your time in office.
Thank you, and I call Basil McRae.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I offer my sincere condolences to Ian Paisley's family. As Mr. Agnew acknowledged earlier in his contribution, it is sometimes difficult on events like this to separate the personal loss with the political legacy. To say that I said advisedly that I liked Ian Paisley. I actually got talking to him towards the end of his political career. And I have to say, I didn't always like Ian Paisley. I didn't always agree with him. In fact, if I'm really honest, almost all of my political awareness since I was growing up would have been against what Ian Paisley was talking about. I did not accept his argument, and I was disappointed about the way that he used his talent. But such was the wonder of the man that actually when you got talking to him, when you got that sense of humour, when you got that interaction, all things appeared to be possible. And I didn't know him perhaps politically in the way that everybody else here in this room will have done. I only saw him towards the end of his career when perhaps he wasn't the orator that he had been earlier. But he still retained that sense of humanity and that willingness to have a wry smile with you that actually smoothed the ways on a lot of issues. So I do acknowledge that his commitment to his family and to his faith is unquestioned. I know some of his family quite well. They too are personalities. They too will have a contribution to make in the coming years. They are a powerful legacy for this place. And the message that I would like to say to them is that we are absolutely at one with their loss. It is the loss of someone very special. But I hope that they use their talent to move forward and bring this place to a better place. It is one thing having great oratorial skills, the great ability to get people to follow you. It is a different thing about getting them to follow you in the right direction. So what I conclude on this message is to say that, yes, indeed, no one can say other than that Ian Paisley dominated politics in Northern Ireland for 40 years or longer. Of course he did, and he will have a legacy. But I hope that that legacy is for a Northern Ireland that is at peace with itself, that is able to build a future, that it is okay to make friends with people that you once thought were your enemy. And I don't agree with some of the assertions that are put forward in this chamber that that is a bad thing. The mark of a man, a big man, is the ability to change your mind. And we witness today the passing of a great man and a big man. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call the Lord Morrow.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. The name of Ian Paisley is known in different tones. Those of us who know him, we affectionately knew him as the big man. Some know him as Lord Bannside, some as the Reverend Ian Paisley, and some, of course, as the Doc. But right at the outset, I would just want to extend my sincere sympathy to Baroness Paisley, to sons Kyle and Ian and Cherith and Rhonda and Sharon at this particular time, and to his brother Harold and sister Margaret. They will miss him the most. Principal Deputy Speaker, it's at times like this you start to reflect on when you first met a person who has passed away. And I can very vividly remember that experience, and it was quite an experience. I was but a stripling, and I remember my first encounter with him, and he was everything in stature that I wasn't. And I felt so very insignificant in his presence. It goes back, actually, to August 1964. I was a boy at school then. I wasn't at primary school, but it seemed as if I was, as I stood there that day. Dr. Paisley, do you see, had a great passion for the lost and the perishing. And he came to conduct a gospel mission in a place called Lahey, Killiman. And for those of you who don't know where it is, it lies about 2.5 miles southwest of Dungannon town. And I remember that first encounter so vividly that I will never, ever forget it. And he left a mark on me that I will never forget either. You know, when I stood there that day as but a boy, and a very small boy, and very small in a whole lot of ways, because I was standing beside a giant. And those of us who are not over 6 feet, when you stand beside someone who's well over it, well, then you do look and feel very small. And that's how I felt that day. But I was struck right away that this man with a big booming voice and the big heart, he had a big heart, and he had a love and a compassion for everyone, irrespective of who they were. And that was my first and lasting impression of Dr. Ian Paisley, or as he is today, Lord Bannside. Can I say to the Assembly today, Dr. Paisley was a challenging, inspirational, persuasive, direct, and sincere in everything that he put his hand to. I am doubtful if there was anyone who had a greater love for his country than Ian Paisley. He was a colossus. This word has been used often. He was a colossus on the political landscape. And whether you agreed with him or not, you could not ignore him. And I suspect even his political opponents today would acknowledge that, that he couldn't be ignored. He was, of course, a man with tremendous faith and passion and zeal unequaled. And I learned many valuable lessons, and they were enduring lessons that have stayed with me to this day. I listened to one of my party colleagues today being asked the question, had he ever been admonished by Dr. Paisley? Well, I want to say to the Assembly, I must have been a good boy, because I cannot recall ever being admonished by. But I do vividly recall being in the room when others, and I'm not talking about Stormonty, I'm talking about other rooms and places, and I just thank God that I wasn't that person. However, when that was all over, it was over, and he moved on to other things. Principal Deputy Speaker, let me say that I count it a great privilege that when Dr. Paisley was elevated to the House of Lords, I was asked to be one of his co-sponsors, along with Lady Boothroyd. And I count that as an honour and a privilege, and will always hold that dear to myself, that he thought me worthy to be one of his co-sponsors on the day he was elevated to the House of Lords. I again want to say how sorry we are as a party, as an individual, and speaking for my wife and family, we miss him the most. Northern Ireland and politics somehow will not be the same without him. Thank you.
Members, first of all, can I just ask members who wish to contribute to stand in their seats in the usual way, rise in their seats? It's because we're not sure of the completeness of the list of names that have been subscribed. And in order to get as many people in as possible, and we've just over half an hour, could I ask members to confine their remarks to 3 minutes? And I call Ms. Katrina Ruan.
Remark at the last concordia. Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. Tomaj Xmuin of Inuwer Clan Paisley, Baroness Paisley, agus a Cuigar Poshti, agus Gar Foshti. Our thoughts are today with Baroness Paisley, their 5 children and their grandchildren. We see Lon agus Fada ag an tusel Ian Paisley. Across Ireland, there are people who would have a very wide range of views about Mr. Ian Paisley during his 88 years of his long life. And I can say without fear or favour that our First Minister has made a contribution to history, and history will obviously analyse that and judge that. Today isn't a day for that. What I would like to focus on today is my dealings with Reverend Ian Paisley during my time on the executive. I have to say, despite the fact that we had very different views on a wide range of issues, I was a feminist. I don't think Ian Paisley ever named himself as a feminist. I was a supporter of equality in education and abolition of the 11 plus. Mr. Paisley had different views, though often I wonder, was he a secret supporter of getting rid of the 11 plus? But we also had very different views on equality in relation to the LGBT community. What I will say is, at all times, he treated me with the utmost courtesy and respect. I never felt his tongue, as Lord Morrow mentioned earlier. He was at all times courteous, and that was during some very fraught debates at the executive that he was jointly chairing with Martin McGuinness. And there were fraught debates on a wide range of issues, and education was at the eye of the storm, or one of the issues that was at the eye of the storm at that time. In fact, I remember coming out of one of the executive meetings, and for some reason I happened to end up in the middle of Ian Paisley and Peter Robinson. And it was just the way we had all walked out from the executive, and I was driving to see my mother, who wasn't well at the time, to Mayo after, and I got some stick in Mayo after the media reports about that. What I admire about Ian Paisley is the role that he played in helping create a peace process. From the first day that he came out in support of power sharing, he didn't resile from that. And I was privileged to be a member of the Sinn Féin team at the first meeting here in Stormont with the DUP. From that day, I watched him. He had made a judgment. It was the right thing to do, and he stuck with that. He wasn't in it half-heartedly. He didn't jump in and out of it. He was in it. He was in it. All aspects. He was equally gregarious at the North-South meetings, I remember him in Dublin, in Dundalk, at various meetings that he was at, and also at the British-Irish Council meetings. And I admire the leadership that he showed in relation to the peace process. At times it couldn't have been easy, and it obviously wasn't easy for him. All of us together created our peace process, and the peace process has changed us all. Agus rinne Ian Paisley a lán obair ar son process níos siachána. And I'd just like to end. My daughter is moving on to another phase of her life, leaving home and going to study. But she had come here at 11 years of age, and without me knowing it, went up and asked Ian Paisley for his autograph. And she got his autograph. And you get a lot of different things throughout her life. But she doesn't keep them all. But we were clearing out her room, and up on her notice board was Ian Paisley's autograph. And I think that's testament to the role that he has played in our peace process. She, like me, is a feminist. She's very progressive on a wide range of issues. But she admired what Ian Paisley did for the peace process at an instinctive level.
And I call Mr. Gregory Campbell.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. Could I join in the sympathies to the Paisley family today? And of course our best wishes go to the Speaker as well as he recovers in hospital. My mind is drawn, Principal Deputy Speaker, to one of the first times that I heard of Ian Paisley, way back in the late 1960s when the troubles were afflicting our province. And I had heard he was to speak at a meeting in Limavady Town Hall. And I, in my naivety as a young teenager, thought that this was a political meeting, even though it was on a Sunday afternoon. And I went along to hear about how Ulster's ills could be remedied. And I did hear of a remedy, but it wasn't a remedy for political ills. It was a remedy that someone like me, who was born in sin, could find a saviour. And that's what he preached unequivocally and absolutely clearly that day. I got to know him, obviously, much better in the years that followed. And I remember in the 1980s, when 1984, when the MLA put a car bomb to try and destroy myself, my wife and my family. And of course that was the day before mobile phones, and we had to go to another home because our own home was sealed off as the army disposal officers tried to deal with the device under our car. Ian Paisley sought out where I was and phoned me to pray and to assure me of his support in the midst of the deepest trauma. And then when a close member of my family, just a few years ago, was nearing the end, and I was in hospital, the phone rang, and it was Ian Paisley on the end of the phone. So he was a man of compassion, a preacher, a politician. He was a man who did not broach subjects with any stealth, but it was full on. Whatever it was, he was full on. Because, and I've read some attempts to rewrite history over the course of the past few days, and we shall deal with them in the course of the next few days. But he was very, very clear in his life and his ministry. Error had to be exposed, and enemies had to be opposed. That was his life. That was what he knew he had to do. And once it came to the point in his life where some of his enemies realised that they couldn't bomb or blast his people, he was prepared to be as assertive in his magnanimity as he was in his opposition. Once he reached that point, he was prepared to go forward. People learned that if you keep asking Ian Paisley the wrong question, you'll get the wrong answer. That's why they got no all the time. But when they asked the right question, they got the right answer. And you know, whenever we come to the point when we all reach the crossing of the Jordan, we need to know that Ian Paisley's saviour is our saviour too. That's what we need to know. And I know that in the corridors of glory today, there's a bit louder singing and a bit louder shouting than there was on Thursday.
Thank you. And I call Mr. Mervyn's story.
Mr. Principal Speaker, it is with a great sense of personal loss and sadness that I stand in this House today. There will never be another of the stature of Ian Paisley, either in church or in state. To me, he will always be the Duke, the big man, that larger-than-life figure whose presence filled the room. It was a privilege for me to know him, not only as my MP and moderator for over 40 years, but as a friend and someone with whom I have shared many occasions and have many, many precious memories. I will always be proud to be called a Paisleyite. My first recollection of Dr. Paisley was of him coming to canvass in my home village of Armoy in the heart of his North Antrim constituency. My father, a local founder member of the Protestant Unionists, which ultimately became the DUP, went to canvass with him around the doors of the village of Armoy. For our family, that was a special day, the day the big man came to visit in our home. But little did I think that one day I would have a greater privilege, that of standing alongside Dr. Paisley in the same elections and in the same ballot paper and represent the same North Antrim constituency which he loved and served faithfully. He married Christian and I some 26 years ago, and to have him share that special day in our lives is indeed an honour. When I was ordained to serve as an elder in Ballymoney Free Presbyterian Church, he was there to be our support and to be by our side. When my late mother passed away in 2000, as has been the case recounted by Gregory, of thousands of families in Northern Ireland, although out of the country, he called our home and spoke and prayed with my father and myself over the phone. Indeed, it was through the faithful preaching of Dr. Paisley that my late mother came to a saving faith in Jesus Christ. What a reunion there has been for them in glory. Dr. Paisley was a faithful political representative for the people of North Antrim and Westminster and Stormont for over 40 years. His thumping majorities, as he achieved in each election, are testament to his devotion to public service and the popularity with his people. Since the sad news broke of Dr. Paisley's death, I have met countless constituents over the weekend from throughout the area who have told me personal accounts of how he had helped them, their family, in their circumstances with their privilege, with their problems. No case was ever too small for Dr. Paisley to deal with. His constituents mattered to him, and his dedication to duty was unwavering. He served the people of North Antrim and Northern Ireland with fairness and diligence and without fear or favour in every forum in which he was elected. Now, there may be one inaccuracy which I feel is necessary for me to set it right in the House this afternoon. Yes, he founded the DUP and the Free Presbyterian Church, but he was not the founder of the Independent Orange Institution. He was born in 1926. That institution was founded in 1903. But I have no doubt that today, in glory, with the late George Dawson and James McClure, colleagues who loved him, they will have had a reunion to recall those days of the past. He was a freeman of the borough of Ballymoney, the first local authority to confer that honour on him in 2001. Because in that town they loved him, and the resolve that they had for him is resounding. In conclusion, Mr. Deputy Principal Speaker, I want to extend to Baroness Paisley, and in particular to my close friend and colleague Ian Paisley Jr., the entire family circle, Mrs. Beggs, and his brother Harold in Canada, my sincere sympathy at the loss of a great man of God. And let us ever be remindful of the words of Scripture that tell us in the Psalm 116, precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Thank you.
Okay. I call Mr. Edwin Putz.
Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and first of all, could I wish well both the Speaker and Minister Kennedy, who are unwell at this time. The greatest tribute to Ian Paisley will not be in the eloquent speeches of people in this chamber, or indeed the well-crafted words of Prime Ministers or statesmen. The greatest tribute to Ian Paisley will be those simple tributes that will come and have come from many men and women over the weekend, is that they came to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ through hearing the preaching of Ian Paisley. I had the privilege from being a very young boy of hearing that preaching. He spoke with fire and fervour, with passion and compassion, with power and conviction. And his impact was felt right across Northern Ireland, but well beyond Northern Ireland. My sister was one of those who came to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ through his preaching. She ended up taking the gospel to the people in the jungles of Papua New Guinea. People in Brazil, many lepers were healed as a result of the work of Bill Woods, who went out there on the support of Ian Paisley and many others. People in the slums of Manila and people in the mountains of Nepal. That is the spread of the man. It isn't just Northern Ireland. It has been a worldwide spread. Here locally, many a drunkard, a gambler, a wife beater sought Jesus Christ after hearing the preaching of Ian Paisley, and made a remarkable difference to families. And he looked on his political opponents as people who could be redeemed as well, because he knew that the Apostle Paul was a man who called himself the greatest sinner, and was actually involved in the killing of people. And he knew that anybody could find forgiveness through the Lord Jesus Christ, and he wanted to spread that gospel irrespective of who it was. My father first stood with Ian Paisley in 1969 as a Protestant Unionist, and he entered this particular chamber in 1973 in the old Northern Ireland Assembly. He walked in with him, he was carried out with him. I had the privilege then of walking in with him again in 1998. And being with him right through till he retired in 2008. The more I got to know Ian Paisley, the more I liked the man. That's not a trait that always happens. And he was more than a colleague. He was caring, he was kind, he was wise, he could be quite crafty. And for me, he was a friend, he was a brother, he was a mentor, but most of all, he was a spiritual father. I had the opportunity of spending time with the family yesterday, and as we recalled stories, we laughed and we considered various things, and we mourned and we wept. And I think that as we gather today and we remember him, we owe it to him and we owe it to future generations to carry through the work that he has done and ensure it is not undone. He wanted peace in our land. He wanted peace in people's hearts. And there is a great work still to be done, and it's our duty to do it.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Jim Wells.
Thank you, Speaker. We've heard many eloquent words here today. I just want to focus on the enormous energy of Dr. Paisley. I worked for the party, the DUP, between 1981 and 1985, and I well remember one night when Dr. Paisley rung me up, it was a Friday evening, and said, "Brother Wells, I want to see you at Aldergove Airport at 6 o'clock. And I said to Dr. Paisley, "That's fine, I'll have a lie-in, I'll have an early lunch, and I'll see you at Aldergove at 6. He said, "At 6 o'clock this morning. And what I also knew was that he was speaking at a DUP dinner in Cash, and Reverend William McCrae was singing. And the Reverend McCrae in those days had this habit of gathering us all around the piano after the event and singing to the small hours. And indeed that happened. We sung to one in the morning. I caught the plane at 6. Dr. Paisley spoke at an annoyance parade in Glasgow. He then came back, picked up his car. He was driven to Londonderry to open a new church, a free church in Londonderry. He then came back that night and spoke to the prisoners in Crumlin Road Prison. He had 4 services on the Sunday, and he bounced into the office on Monday morning as bright as a daisy, and I was absolutely exhausted, and all I'd done was follow him. And that was the type of man he was. He had the most enormous energy. No one can understand how anyone could work so hard as Dr. Paisley. He often joked and said that he had a day's work done before most men were out of their bed, and I can confirm that was true. He never seemed to sleep. He would regularly ring you at 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning asking for something to be done. But I also saw the spiritual side of Dr. Paisley. I was in Refreilin campaigning, and he heard that someone who admired him greatly, but it wasn't a member of his church, was facing the valley of the shadow of death. He was about to pass away from cancer. He dropped everything, he went to that house, and the comfort and the succour and the support that he gave that family, I will never, ever forget. No one could handle that type of situation better than Dr. Paisley. And whilst there's thousands of people from Northern Ireland who will bless the day that they attended a mission or a service where Dr. Paisley preached, there are many other thousands we won't hear about who've passed through into death with the comfort and the support of Dr. Paisley, and no one could do that better. I have so many memories over this last 40 years. Northern Ireland, Ulster, the United Kingdom, Ireland are a much poorer place for his passing. There will never, ever be another Ian Paisley. Even if Ian Paisley had been nothing more than a carpenter or a plumber, he would have been well known in his community. But he was so much more. He's a man that I will find enormous privilege to tell my grandchildren, I knew Ian Paisley, and I think it's a great honour to be able to say that.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Paul Frew.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. And I rise with great sadness this historic day within this chamber. Again, I can boast that I am more younger than most people who have spoken here today. And my first recollection of the great man Paisley was in the early 80s, when as a young boy, I'm sure on a tricycle or at least in a bike that had stabilisers, when Paisley came to visit someone or a household or even just to canvass, Dr. Paisley would have had an entourage that no one or no one else could compare. When Paisley was in your street, when Dr. Paisley was in your area, you knew about it, and so did that community. And that community would have congregated around that street or around that house to even catch a glimpse of that great man, or to even say hello to Dr. Paisley. And that's why none of us here could ever compare with the man, Dr. Paisley. And many things have been said here about him, and many things have been written about him throughout his life. But I would like to concentrate on Dr. Paisley, the servant, because that's what Dr. Paisley was, first and foremost. I grew up with Dr. Paisley as a childhood hero. Some might say that's sad. Why would you have a politician as a hero? But he was much more than a politician. He was much more than that. For many people in North Antrim and Ballymena, he was their hero. And that is because he served them. And that is because he helped them. And what Dr. Paisley done for constituency work is that he got that mould and he broke it. And he set a new standard that no one from that day to now has ever had the energy or the passion or the compassion to ever match. We can all in this room try, but I doubt any of us will be able to match that energy and that work rate and that commitment to the people, not only of North Antrim, but also of Northern Ireland, when he served them in Westminster and in Europe, and indeed in this house. He also, if I pay tribute to him, he also was a family man, but not only a family man in the true sense of the word, but around these benches here today, he created a family that worked tirelessly and followed him and tried to be like him and tried to work like him, tried to have the energy like him. And if there's anything that we around these benches can do today and forevermore, is to try and match that energy and that commitment. That will be our lasting tribute to the people, to the person that we know affectionately as Doc.
And before I call the next speaker, could I just point out that already some people who have taken the trouble to put their name down are not going to be called because we're simply going to run out of time. If people could just respect the 3-minute rule or possibly even curtail their remarks to give these all colleagues an opportunity. Sir Jonathan Bell.
Privilege to pay a tribute to the Reverend Dr. Ian Richard Kyle Paisley, Lord Bannside. In one way, I believe Ian has, I know with certainty, that Ian has already heard the greatest of all tributes, because he has already heard the well done, good and faithful servant. And so on this day that this great son of Ulster is laid to rest, we're to turn our thanks, as Ian would want us to do, because he always put God first in his life. We return our thanks to God for that love that sought him and the blood that bought him and the grace that brought him to the fold and how faithfully he preached Christ crucified. To be alongside Ian was to know and to understand that Christ was his strength and that Christ was his might. The fire of the Reformation burned strongly with Dr. Paisley, and he embodied in that hymn something that we should all dedicate ourselves to, that faith of our fathers, the holy faith that he was true to until death. He was an amazingly well-read man, a powerful orator. I don't need to pay tribute to his strengths as a politician. He long ago entered into that pantheon of great unionist leaders. I can remember him telling me how difficult it was when Eileen confined him to bring in 3,000 of his favourite books to their new home because he just short of 34,000 that he was going to choose from. He was a man of great humour and pastor's heart. I can remember coming back as a student one night after putting up posters at midnight in Belfast City Centre with a Kentucky Fried Chicken bucket to their house and how he came in from whatever meeting he was at. And he sat down with us at his kitchen table. He filled a pint glass full of ice cubes and filled it to the brim with red schlure and sat and joked with us to the early hours of the morning. We got up as students the next day, just short of lunchtime, to learn that Dr. Paisley had been outside the shipyard in East Belfast at 6:30 in the morning campaigning for the European election. He was an orator of excellence. He could politically face down the worst evils of terrorism, and he could still rejoice in his faith. I don't know, I'll conclude now, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, hearing your words, but how do you ever finish with a tribute to Ian? Ian always wrote Ephesians 6, 9 and 10, and I thought of that. But today, as the Reverend William McCrae would have sang with him, there are no wreaths of death on Doc's mansion door, because teardrops aren't welcome beyond the gates of glory, because that heart will never break anymore. And that Paisley family, who Doc held their hand right up until Friday afternoon, who cared for him so well, until a higher hand came and took his other hand to bring him home. And we do say, that finish the words of the doxology, no pun intended, how great is the God we adore, our faithful, unchangeable friend, whose love is as great as his power and who knows neither measure nor end. For it was to Jesus, the first and the last. His spirit has guided him safe home. We'll praise him for all that is past and trust him for all that's to come.
Going to call Mr. Ian McCrae.
Mr. Speaker, firstly, on behalf of my entire family circle, can I offer our sincere sympathies to Baroness Paisley and her family on the passing of their loved one, and our friend, Lord Bannside, or as others have said, as he is affectionately known to us as the Doc. I've had the honour of knowing Dr. Paisley all my life. In fact, I don't recall it, but as a child he came to my dad's church to dedicate me as a young boy, and I suppose it came as no surprise that if ever there was to be a firstborn boy in our house that would be christened, it surely was to be christened after Ian Paisley, and I know that, and he's always told me how proud he was that I carried on that name. Over the years, my dad, and it's good to see him here today, has had a very close bond with Dr. Paisley, and he shared the pulpit with him, He was an assistant to him in Belfast as a teenager. He was a colleague in the ministry for well over 40 years. He shared the benches of Parliament at Westminster and here with Dr. Paisley, and indeed also shared a prison cell in Crumlin Road Jail. So I'm not sure there's too many can say all that, but growing up as a boy, I have many, many memories of Dr. Paisley coming to our home. And I suppose as a one of five, I always claimed that I was his favourite. Mind you, it must have been the fact because he always sent home now and again a gift with Dad from Westminster for me, that the others didn't get. So there may be some truth in it, but I'll hold fast to that anyway. But I have numerous memories of Dr. Paisley, and I'll always cherish them, and we'll all have our own memories. But whether it was his coming to Macrofelt to open the Loyalist Arch, whether it was the time he spent in our home, his preaching at Dad's church, or indeed the Easter Convention at the Martyrs Memorial or here at Stormont, Dr. Paisley always took the time to ask how things were with me, my family, and always had a genuine interest and showed that he cared. Since hearing of Dr. Paisley's passing, I have been overwhelmed by the number of constituents and others who approached me to express their sympathy, and I want to ensure that the family are aware of that today. There'll never be another Dr. Paisley in my lifetime. He was a giant both in the political world, as a minister of the gospel, and I believe that Ian Paisley was God's man for Ulster's hour of need. Dr. Paisley will be greatly missed. His seat is now empty, but many of us will carry on his memories within our hearts. He loved this province and always gave hope in the darkest day. He brought comfort to many over the years, especially those whose lives were wrecked by terrorism. He stood up for the rights of the ordinary man. He was a true Ulster man, and through his leadership has left a legacy for the hope for generations to come. Mr. Speaker, in conclusion, I just want to recall the hymn that he always sang at the closing of the Easter Convention, and that was, "Till we meet, till we meet, till we meet again, till we meet at Jesus' feet. Till we meet, till we meet again, God be with you till we meet again." And I thank God by his saving grace that I will meet Ian Paisley at Jesus' feet. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call Mr. Gordon Dunn.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker, and I too count it a great honour today to stand and pay a tribute to Dr. Paisley, who I knew as my pastor, who I seen as a great leader and a friend, and a family friend who was very close to my late father and mother, who, as many know, I was brought up in County Fermanagh, and my father and mother were great followers of Dr. Paisley throughout the 70s. Having moved to North Down, I got involved in politics there and was involved in many election campaigns. And I remember the days in Bangor Market. We had a famous lady from Bangor, I'm sure a lot of you remember, Beryl Holland, who was a great friend and colleague of Dr. Paisley's, and in many ways challenged him about how he carried on his business. But those were some of the people that backed Dr. Paisley in the early days. And the important thing he had was the ability to link with ordinary people. And he always remembered the ordinary person in the street. I think that's an important lesson for all of us today. As a pastor in the Martyrs Memorial Church, he conducted our wedding almost 30 years ago. He dedicated our three children. And he was a faithful minister and pastor for over 60 years. I remember him as a great leader in Europe, in Westminster and in the Northern Ireland Assembly, and as First Minister. He made very brave decisions, and I think he made the right decision. And I do personally believe that the future of this Assembly is secure because of Ian Paisley. An example of the outpouring of the people of this province in respect of Dr. Paisley was just on Friday. Shortly after the announcement was made, a lady came straight to our office in Holywood with a card for Mrs. Paisley, a Roman Catholic lady who rushed out and bought a card and brought it to our office to be passed on as a mark of respect. I think I've said enough. Dr. Paisley has run his race. He has finished the course. He has kept the faith. Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker.
Stephen Moutrie.
Thank you, Mr. Principal Deputy Speaker. My first real-life experience of Dr. Ian Paisley was in the early 1970s when he came to speak at political open-air rallies in the Mournview estate in Lurgan. I remember him speaking from a platform which comprised of an open-top lorry to maybe a crowd of some 500 people. Ian Paisley had a charisma which was lacking in unionism at that time. He appealed to all sections of the unionist community, but particularly to the working class people whom he represented so well. My family background was not connected either politically or spiritually with what Ian Paisley represented, but I admired the man from those days for his honesty, his forthrightness, and his determination, sometimes against all odds. In later years, through both political and church involvement, I got to know Dr. Paisley well, and indeed his family, and I found him a person of total integrity, caring, compassionate, and I remember being out in the election trail with him, and that in itself was an experience. He always had time for the ordinary people in the street. Ian Paisley made a tremendous impact on the life of this province. He was a force for good, and I believe that Ulster is a much better place today because of his contribution. To Baroness Paisley, our colleague Ian, and the rest of the family, I extend my condolences from both myself, my wife, and my family. Yet even at this time of sadness, we are consoled to know that, as Philippians 1:23 says, he is with Christ, which is far better.
And I call Mr. Paul Given.
Thank you. Ephesians chapter 6, 19 and 20 are verses in the Bible that say, "And for me that utterance may be given unto me, that I may open my mouth boldly, to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in bonds, that therein I may speak boldly as I ought to speak." Those of us that have Dr. Paisley's signature, as I do on my Bible, he always ascribed those texts to his name and how he lived out those verses in his life, in the pulpit and in politics. It's a privilege for me to speak on this day as a tribute to him. Today we have lost a son of Ulster. We've lost a mighty man of God. Dr. Paisley was the embodiment of what it is to be for God and Ulster. He had an impact on my life that was immense. My grandfather and his two brothers were founding members of the Protestant Unionist Party that then became the DUP. My father followed him, and I will always be, and proud to be, known as a Paisleyite. I wear it as a badge of honour. He connected generations of my family in a special way, and he made an impact upon thousands of people. I thank God for his ministry in the Martyrs' Memorial. When my wife, 16 years ago, at a youth rally, responded to his sermon and put her trust in the Lord Jesus Christ as her own personal saviour, I and thousands of others followed Dr. Paisley because he led us in a closer walk with God. Today, our hearts are broken, and we mourn with his family, but we are not without hope, for Dr. Paisley is with the Lord. And at church on Friday, we sang that song, "Rock of Ages, Cleft for Me," for which Dr. Paisley penned a fifth verse to. And it says, "Then above the world and sin, through the veil drawn right within, I shall see him face to face, sing this story, saved by grace. Rock of ages, cleft for me, let me ever be with thee." Dr. Paisley is at home in glory, but we hear his voice loudly as he says to those that remain, "Put on the whole armour of God. Fight the good fight. Press toward the mark. Run the race that is set before you. And God be with you till we meet again."
Thank you. And that brings an end to the tribute to Lord Bannside. And I would ask the leaders of the political parties in the chamber to join me in the rotunda, where we will proceed to the opening and the signing of the Book of Condolence. And members thereafter would be afforded the opportunity. And the Book of Condolence will be available for members, users of this book. building and staff members until 3 p.m. this afternoon, when the book will then be open to the public. And can I finally just express my thanks and appreciation to all the members for the sincerity of their comments and the conduct of this discussion on the life and times and contribution of Dr. Ian Paisley. Thank you all very much. And the question is that the Assembly do now adjourn, and the Assembly is adjourned.